can see the Bible tells us that all nations will come against Israel in the last day. We can see that happening in Buckingham Palace. I mean, God has been removed, our God, the God of the Jews, the Christian God, Jesus Christ has
the real God.
has been removed off the world stage and is being removed every single day.
You know, just like last week we showed the prophecy of Daddy in 2014, where he said about the itching for a new kind of war with America,
yes,
and with the West. And that new kind of war has really had a lot to do with propaganda, yes, and information and the war on the mind of the citizens.
House of Destiny, it's so good to be with you. Wherever you are, I just want to encourage you to lift up a shout of praise, because God is so good. He is the God of His Word. We can stand on His truth, on His promise. So we're going to declare today how good He is. Hey. Thank you, Lord, for your word, Jesus. You said, your word is a lamp unto your way is the only way for me. I know it's a narrow road that leads to life, but I want to be on. It's a narrow road, but the mercy's wide, and you're good on your promise. We say, I'll take you at your word. If you said it, seen how good it was. If you started, you'll complete it. I'll take you at your word. Oh, cause you're good on your promise. And you spoke in the chaos. Oh, cause I know, Lord, cause I've seen. Started, you're completed. I'll take you at your word. Could you
you. We trust in your faithfulness, your consistency. You're never changing. And wherever you're watching from, I want to encourage you to fix your eyes on the consistent one. We fix our eyes on the consistent one, not on what's going on around me, but on the God who is consistent, never changing, and never failing. This is a house of worship. This is a place of praise, where every demon trembles, where we proclaim your name. This is a house of healing. We believe our hearts are full of faith. Yes, they are. You have our full attention. You have the final say. We prophesy and sing. Come alive. In the name of Jesus, come alive. In the name of Jesus, this is a house of miracles. We bring everything to the feet of Jesus.
Everything, yeah. In the name of Jesus,
this is a house of miracles. Oh. We believe and we know you're able. We believe and we know you're able. There's resurrection power. Your blood runs through our veins. Oh yeah. Your kingdom triumphs over. Even the coldest grave. Oh, come alive in the name of Jesus. Come alive in the name of Jesus. This is
a house of miracles.
Yeah, we believe and we know that we can bring everything to the feet
of Jesus.
Come on, sing that over them one more time. Oh, we sing, come alive.
In the name of Jesus.
You can come alive.
In the name of Jesus. This is a house of miracles.
Yeah, yes it is. Oh, we bring everything to.
Everything to the feet of Jesus.
Everything to.
In the name of Jesus.
Yeah. I still believe you're speaking. God, I believe you're working all things for good. I fix my eyes. Yeah, sing that. God, I
receive your vision. All things for good.
Yeah, I still believe
you're moving.
I still believe
you're speaking.
Yeah, we put our faith in you,
all
Jesus.
All things for good. I fix my eyes on heaven.
God, I receive your vision. God, I come on, let's sing that again. Oh, God, I still believe you're moving. God,
I believe you're speaking.
Name of Jesus. Yeah, sing that out. Oh, 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 oh,
everything to the feet of Jesus.
Everything.
Come on, let's take it to the bridge right here.
I still believe you're moving. I still believe
you can believe he's able.
Lord, I believe you.
This for me.
Oh, because even when I don't see it, you're working. And even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop. Even when
I don't see it,
you're working. Yeah. And even when
you can believe that right now in the middle of your situation.
He never stops. Whoa. Don't feel it, you work.
Even when I don't feel it,
you never stop working. You never stop.
Even when I don't see it,
you're always working.
Yeah.
Even when I don't feel it, you work.
You never stop. I feel like that's praying for someone right now.
Even when miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
We declare that over someone today.
He's way maker.
You can believe again, you can hope again now.
Way maker, miracle work, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
We speak to your hopelessness and we say,
come alive in the name of Jesus, come alive in the name of Jesus. This is a house of miracles. Everything to the feet of Jesus. Everything in the name of Jesus. This is a house of miracles.
Jesus, we don't want anything else but you. Nothing else will do. You're more than every dream come true. All of the things I thought I wanted don't come close to knowing you. Now that I'm yours and you are mine, our love is the secret. doubt's been forever in the pleasure I found looking in your eyes. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You than silver, more than gold. You are the treasure that I hold. Now that I've tasted of your goodness, nothing else can satisfy. Give me
can have it all.
can have it all. I just want you. 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 I just want you.
Hello, House of Destiny. We have a new Boots on the Ground missions update just for you. And we are going to update you on all of the things that we have our hands into with your Seeds of Love. Starting with Raja, they actually have a TAPVC, and that is a critical congenital condition of the heart needing to be corrected in early infancy in order to survive. So their life is dependent on having a surgery. And it's very interesting because the parents had to travel by train for many hours all throughout the night to be able to get to a specific location to for their child to receive this heart surgery, and it was funded by your giving. So what a miracle. Came through that surgery with flying colors, and Raja is doing well and expected to live a full life. And Miles was born with a large hole between the ventricle of his heart, and he was significantly smaller than all the other children his age. And unfortunately, the family, again, same situation, was unable to afford the surgery needed to save his life. But our Unity program was able to get him in, get the entire surgery funded, and that was all because of your giving. So with your Seeds of Love, these are just two examples of what that does. It goes to save lives, to give hope, to give a future. So your Seeds of Love aren't falling on infertile ground. It's falling on something that can grow and blossom into true life and have a long life. So you are supplying miracles in children just like these all over the world. If you are watching and you are not yet a partner and you're like, man, I have to become a part of that, just click the link right there on your screen. Become a partner with us today, and let's continue to impact children's lives all around the world.
It's our time to honor God. Let's join together as one. Everybody say, as one. You know, there's something powerful about being one. It's not what you find in the world. It's what you find in the kingdom of God. One will chase 1,000, two will chase 10,000, and a threefold cord is not easily broken. It's time, as we're one, for us to honor the Lord in our offering, and it's time for God to give you a breakthrough. It's time for God to move powerfully for His people in the earth when the earth is in famine, when the earth is shaking, when the kingdoms of this world are trying to dictate darkness against us, but we live in the kingdom of light, the kingdom of God's dear Son. You know, Proverbs 11, verse 24 and 25 says, "One person gives freely, yet gains even more. Another withholds unduly and comes to poverty. A generous person will prosper. Whoever refreshes others will be refreshed. People say, I don't know why it's not working for me. Well, first of all, let me tell you that just because we do something righteous doesn't mean that it's not going to be tested, and it doesn't mean that it's going to instantaneously in the natural produce results, because there is seed time and harvest. So you got to let time take its time and then be patient on the Lord and wait on the Lord. But God always comes through. And generosity is the name of the game, folks, if you'll let me call it that, because that's what this ministry is built on. Now, as I like to say, let's not be takers, let's be givers. I promise you, in every church, in every ministry, with every broadcast, you have a lot of takers. We don't mind giving. That's what God has called us to do. And we freely give. But there has to be givers. There has to be, even if it's a small percent, God will use a small percent to do all of the work. Unfortunately, that's normally the way that it is. But here's the thing. He promises to supply our every need. And if you want it, you want the kingdom of God to work for you, then do what Proverbs 11 talks about. He says, there's one who freely gives, and yet he gains even more. People say, I don't know how these people can do what they're doing. They're giving, 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 and yet they're receiving so much more. That's the mathematics of the kingdom of God. Below the player, you click on all those beautiful buttons that we provided for you. You can text to give. There's many ways to give, and just do whatever you need to do. But what we're asking people to do is help us to carry the vision. Help us to reach children in Cambodia. Help us to reach sinners around the world with the good news of forgiveness in Jesus Christ. And when you give $25 or more, you can receive this beautiful book that we put together, many of Kim's letters that he wrote. We put it in book form. There's revelation in it. There's powerful prophetic writings in this, and you can get it for $25 or more. Thank you for doing that. And let me close with this. Someone wrote in and said, Donnie, I just want to say that I love you and I thank you for sharing your dad with us. Such a blessing. Thank you. Lycia. Now, you know, Kim's in heaven, and you're giving us the ability through God to continue to introduce the prophetic ministry, the Word of God, to generations around the world. Thank you for helping us. We're going to do it, and God's going to give us people like you to help us and to provide for the gospel of Jesus Christ. God bless you. We pray blessings upon your life and multiplication now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Welcome to Current Events. Well, Israeli leaders insist on entering Rafah to end the war. So let's watch this clip, and when we come back, Donna and I are going to speak about it. Let's go to the clip now.
Israel's defense minister, Yoav Gallant, says the pullout is a sign that Hamas is severely weakened as a fighting force.
Hamas ceased to function as a military organization throughout the Gaza Strip.
But within an hour, Hamas terrorists were firing rockets at seven Israeli communities from the area the IDF troops had just left.
On the tactical level, what you can read into it is that the IDF is pulling out troops in order to get them some rest and time to reorganize in order to be prepared for the next stage of missions. That's one way of looking at it.
Jonathan Kenricus, a former IDF spokesman and a lieutenant colonel in the reserves, says that next stage of mission would be an invasion of Rafah. He also says the move can be seen as a result of American pressure.
There was a few days ago an important and reportedly heated conversation between the president and the prime minister, and demands were made, and you could think that what Israel is doing now is an implementation of those demands.
Kanrika says the IDF is also preparing for a greater conflict with Hezbollah.
Time will have to tell, and we will have to wait which one of the options it was, but it could be either one or a combination of all.
Still, as fighting reaches the six-month mark, Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu sees the elimination of Hamas just ahead.
We're marking today 6 months of war. We're one step away from victory.
Netanyahu and Gallant insist on an invasion of Rafah, where Hamas's last intact battalions are holding up. As it has for weeks, the White House disagrees.
And the White House disagrees. What do you think, Donna?
Well, the thing is, it's been very intense, you know, and the Israeli government is so complicated when they're saying the prime minister and the president, and you're thinking, what?
It's the prime minister and Biden.
I do know, but it can get quite quite confusing sometimes when you look at it. But definitely, look, they can't just, what are they supposed to do, just stop in the middle?
Well, that's what the Biden administration wants them to do. But then you see they pull out, and what do you see next? Rockets firing towards Israel. And now they want the whole world wants this problem in Israel to go away. But the problem in Israel is not going to go away until the Jews deal with this problem on their borders.
Yes.
And they're surrounded at the moment. They've got the Hezbollah up in the north.
Yes.
Of course, they did that attack in Damascus, and now the world is waiting to see what Iran is going to do. Are they going to use their proxies, or are they going to actually fire directly from Iran? Because if they fire directly from Iran, then Israel has a legitimate reason to respond.
Yes.
And they will try and take out those nuclear sites. And this is a very, very big deal. Let's go to the next clip now and see what Netanyahu has to say about it.
On Monday, Netanyahu announced Israel is not finished with Hamas in Gaza.
We're working all the time to achieve our goals, primarily the release of our hostages and achieving a complete victory over Hamas. This victory requires entry into Rafah and the elimination of the terrorist battalions there. It will happen. There's a date.
After months of on and off negotiations, the U.S. has reportedly proposed a new ceasefire deal. It would see a six-week halt in the fighting and exchange 40 hostages for 900 Palestinians imprisoned in Israel. Hamas is expected to respond to this latest proposal by Tuesday night. If they agree, the truce could begin as soon as Wednesday. The Biden administration has warned it could change its policy towards Israel if it goes forward with an invasion of Rafah. There are also signs it would like to see Netanyahu replaced as leader. Monday, the U.S. Secretary of State held high-level talks with the leader of Netanyahu's opposition, who might be more pliable to White House demands.
A hostage deal is doable. It is a difficult deal. This is a deal we might not like, but it's doable, and therefore it needs to be made.
Five families related to the hostages met with Pope Francis Monday, who they say described Hamas in no uncertain terms.
He called Hamas evil, which they are. He called them bad guys and evil. And he was very clear that the hostages need to come home.
What's so infuriating about this whole thing, Donna, is the fact that the United States is trying to tell Israel who to vote for. Meanwhile,
yes,
the whole population, majority of the population, agree with Netanyahu, mm-hmm, that he needs to go into Rafah and take care of the last remnants of
Yes, and they have to finish this.
They have to.
It is necessary, because otherwise it's just, I mean, like we just saw, they're just going to be shooting. I mean, the minute Israel's backing off, they're going to be attacking
again.
Well,
you saw it in that first clip.
Yes. And so, you know, firing rockets like that. And they've got all of these hostages still. I saw the parents of one of the boys whose arm got blown off. And, you know, the mom and dad, they've been quite vocal. I've forgotten their names now. I wish I could remember. But I just thought about it. You know, it's this is a very long time. These people are waiting, not knowing about their families. And it really is awful.
And there they are showing the pictures of their family members. But do you know that we here in the United States have not seen one picture of the 10 United States hostages that are under those tunnels in Gaza? We have not seen one photograph of them. We do not know their names.
That's not good.
This is a very serious thing that's going on. And I think that all that they're worried about is the next election and Donald Trump.
That's all they're worrying about. And you know what? These people are so blinded by this. It is demonic the way this goes on. And also the Biden administration, you know, we couldn't expect anything else from these people at this stage. I mean, you know how corrupt they are, what they've done in Ukraine. And the tactic is to replace the leadership, like they were saying, with someone that will go along with what we want. And this is another country. It isn't, it's the same sort of thing that's going on, not just with Israel, but all over the place. It's the same kind of tactics being used over and over again. And really the corruption in leadership has to be taken care of in America. And that's why you see everybody, it's like people are either for Trump, like super for Trump, or they hate him so much that no matter what anybody says about anything, they always have to bring Trump into things that have nothing to do with it. And so I say that because you can see it is not just natural things going on. There is a spiritual element to this.
Definitely.
And definitely a demonic element to it, to where, you know, just like last week we showed the prophecy of Daddy in 2014, where he said about the itching for a new kind of war with America and with the West. And that new kind of war has really had a lot to do with propaganda and information and the war on the mind of the citizens. And so, again, you look at the situation in Israel, and no matter where you go in the world, the way Israel, what is expected of Israel and the way they are treated, no one else has to abide by these standards.
No.
And this is coming from, you know, the UN and a lot of the Middle Eastern countries there that hate Israel. Yes. It is infiltrated into all kinds of places of leadership and media and entertainment. And that propaganda that, you know, in World War One and Two, we saw bits of paper with propaganda on it. Now it's in your hand all day long. They can, you know, do with the technology we have with video and things, they can do all kinds of things to edit things, to cut things a certain way so they sound a certain way. And then they manipulate the masses and the minds of the people. It's a very dangerous thing going on.
They use propaganda and they use our moral values.
Yes.
They use our moral values.
Your compassion.
Our compassion to... against us.
Yes.
And this is what they've done with taking the hostages to start with. They take the hostages. They do not care. They do not care about individual people. They do not care. It's the goal of the Islamic world. It's an ideology that has taken control. And it's actually snowboarding to such a degree that they are even having Islamic prayers in Buckingham Palace today.
Yes, and I've heard this.
Yes, in Buckingham Palace. I mean, God has been removed, our God, the God of the Jews, the Christian God, Jesus Christ has been removed off the world stage and is being removed every single day. I mean, I spoke about it last week when I spoke about... you know, Christians, the Bible's been removed from schools, from the Ten Commandments have been removed. I mean, they've just obliterated Christianity. They're trying to obliterate it off the face of the earth.
They are, absolutely. It's obvious Christians are being blamed for everything, unless you're a certain kind of Christian. If you accept certain things like abortion and gay marriage, there's Christians out there that are lining up with that. And then you wonder what kind of Christian would be able to, especially when it comes to abortion, But unless you fit into that, so it's sort of like a state religion. If you remember, Dad, years ago, after he sent me to Europe on that trip, he brought the German people in to speak to us, those people from Germany, and they were talking to us about the state church and what was going on in Germany back then. And when you look at what's going on in America now and in the West, it's a push to get rid of the Christian nationalists or people who won't, like I said, go along with abortion is okay, gay marriage is okay. Those kind of Christians are fine. Mm-hmm. So it makes me think of the lukewarm.
Well, it makes me think of, you prophesied in my name.
Yes.
You did miracles in my name. Depart me from me, you workers of iniquity. Mm-hmm. I never knew you. Now, that is the most scariest scripture in the Bible to me. You know, the Bible is a Jewish book. And the Jews, we have Jesus Christ because of the Jews. And, of course, Satan is doing his utmost to get Christians and Jesus Christ off the face of the earth, because if he can do that, he thinks he can thwart the plan of God and the end of the book, the Bible. There is a story unfolding, the story from creation all the way through the Bible. There is, and every single prophecy of the Old Testament prophets have been so accurate that you cannot deny it. I mean, from the birth of Christ, all the way through to the different wars that have happened in the Bible that were predicted and came to pass. And everything that is happening right now, and we can see Ezekiel 38, we can see the nations of the world on the border of Israel. We can see the Bible tells us that all nations will come against Israel in the last day. We can see that happening. You know, this problem with Lebanon, that's the Hezbollah that's coming against Israel right now. There are some Lebanese Christians in Lebanon that are standing up against Nasrallah. And this is, his name was Pascal Suleiman. I can't pronounce the name.
Suleiman.
But anyway, he was the Lebanese Forces Party official who was kidnapped, has been found brutally murdered in the border area between Syria and Lebanon. He was a senior member of the Christian Lebanese political party. Hezbollah claims that it was an attempt to steal his car that went wrong, but no one in Lebanon buys this load of horse manure. Lebanon is burning from within, and that is the last thing Hezbollah needs right now, as it is bracing for a war with Israel in the coming weeks. The tensions between Hezbollah and the Christians are rising swiftly in Lebanon. And of course, then Nasrallah stood up and he's trying to give a speech, and it's all aimed at the Christians. So let's go to the clip and watch this.
What happened last night and today is a big lesson for all of the Lebanese. And allow me to say, especially to the Christians, and a major scandal for both the Lebanese force and the Lebanese Falangist Party and everyone who supported them last night and today. It's a real scandal. And they were exposed for what they truly are, not the people of integrity, nor the people of truth, nor the people of justice, nor are they concerned with the national interest, nor with civil peace, nor caring about anything. They are sowers of discord, searching for civil war, and this is a true testament to this matter. It means they sent messages to people living in the area of Jabil and Kirshwan, and they started making threats and intimidating. This is very dangerous. This is something that cannot be overlooked. Not easy at all. This is a very, 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 very dangerous step. Until breath is cut off, they must understand this truth.
It has been confirmed Pascal Suleiman has been killed in Syria. The army intelligence are currently working with the Red Cross to recover his body from Syria. This incident sparked outrage among protesters who have begun destroying cars in the area, as many are still here in Jbeil. Pascal Sleiman was the Lebanese forces coordinator of Jbel. He was kidnapped on Sunday in Kehil, and this sparked condemnation from different political parties and leaders. The leader of the Lebanese forces, Samir Jaja, and several MPs gathered in Jbel to follow up on the developments on Sunday. And on Monday night, it has been confirmed that Pascal Sleiman has been killed in Syria. Now the investigation is still ongoing, and the Lebanese forces will issue a statement and will react to the situation following the investigation and the recovery of the body of Sleiman.
So there you can see that there is an uprising. The Christians are uprising in Lebanon, and this is a good thing. And I think that it would be really a great idea if Israel actually armed the Christians in Lebanon, but I don't think that's going to happen. But that would be a good idea,
wouldn't it?
It would be a good idea. It would really help Israel out.
Because again, we're seeing this against Christians now.
Yes.
Now you see it. We're hearing what we hear in India and other places.
Right.
And now everywhere it just keeps popping up again and again and again. These Christians,
exactly.
The Christians are the problem.
Well, in defiance of Nasrallah, the Maimonite Christian patriarch of Lebanon delivers a sermon against Hezbollah today, against the background of the growing enmity between the Christians, especially the Maimonites and Hezbollah. He calls Hezbollah bloodthirsty warlords. Who gave you a license for human history? Do not think that you are strong with your weapons. You are the weakest of the weak. Now, that was the patriarch speaking. So you can see there there is an uprising. There is conflict going on in Lebanon. And if you understand the situation in Lebanon, the Litani River is where Israel wants them to move beyond the Litani River. And the Litani River is a border that they keep speaking about, that the Hezbollah has crossed over that they shouldn't have. And so this is the conflict that's going on. Israel wants to push them back beyond the Litani River. And the Christians in Lebanon are having this issue, Donne.
Yeah. So on top of India, and of course, the Middle East, what we don't even know goes on, because you hear all sorts of things, even from Saudi Arabia and on. And again, these are not Christians who are Westerners.
No.
These Christians are from these. It's not like, you know, it's Westerners that have moved there. It's not like that. It's Christians within their country, their own country. That's their country.
Yes.
But they don't have religious freedom the way we do in America. And so you see, who is the one group who's going to get it? It's really going to be the Christians, because the Christian message is everything about the Christian message is the opposite of what a tyrannical, controlling, governing power, especially one that's corrupt, wants, because Christianity is a big problem for them. Western belief is a big problem for them because it gives responsibility to the individual instead of being able to put people in groups and try to divide them.
Yes.
We're individuals. And all those surface things that they try to use against us to, again, keep us divided and distracted, things like race and these other things, gender. When you come to Christianity, you're not judged on your flesh. And so it becomes a very difficult problem for these governing powers all over the world, because there is a globalist agenda. It's very difficult for them. Christianity tends to be the most difficult, and Judaism too. But you'll find, so when the Bible is, when Jesus himself said what we would as Christians go through, you can see how it's happening. And it's all because of the message of what Christianity is about. It'd be very difficult to try to whitewash that very foundational message of Christianity.
Well, you know, I always speak about prophecies in the Bible. I bring prophecies to the fore and speak about them. Ezekiel 38, Isaiah 17, Jeremiah 49, Zechariah 13, 14, 12, 13 and 14, and Today, I'm going to speak to you about what Obadiah says. Obadiah has one chapter in the Bible, and it's all about God's plan it's basically speaking about Edom, which is Jordan, and what's going to happen to Jordan in the end times. And you can read the first portion of it, but if you want to go back and read Obadiah. But I'm going to read from verse 15 because that's more speaking about Israel and what God intends is going to happen to Israel and to the land that surrounds Israel and what belongs to Israel according to God. So Obadiah chapter 1 verse 15. The day of the Eternal's judgment for all the nations is near. Whatever evil you have done will be done to you. Your deeds will come crashing back on your head. Just as you drank to the defeat of my people on my holy mountain. Now, when it speaks about my holy mountain, it's talking about the Temple Mount. Now, you and all the nations around you will always drink excessively. They will be forced to drink and guzzle a mouthful of suffering, and it will be as if they never existed. But on Mount Zion, that's the Temple Mount, will be a place of safety. Some will escape to that holy hill, and the people of Jacob, which is talking about Israel, will conquer and possess those who conquered and dispossess them. The people of Jacob, of course, talking about Israel, will become a fire and the family of Joseph a flame. They will ignite and consume the people of Esau as they execute divine punishment until only dry stubble remains. No one from the people of Esau will survive, so declares the Eternal One. The people from the southern desert will take over Mount Esau, and those from the foothills will flood into the Palestine's coastal plain, that's Gaza. They will possess the fertile lands of Ephraim and Samaria, and Benjamin's people will inhabit Gilead. The army of exiled sons and daughters of Israel will stream back home and live along the coast and possess the Canaanites as far as Zarephath, and the exiles of Jerusalem who lived in Sepharad will settle down in the cities and villages of the south. These deliveries will go up to Mount Zion, my holy hill. Now, when he talks about Zarephath, that is just beyond the Litani River, which is in Lebanon. And it's just amazing to me to see how what God is predicting through Obadiah is what's going to happen. So we can watch and see what's going to happen. And we know that Israel is going to possess the land that God intended for them to possess. The message of Obadiah is that despite Israel's sin, God will judge those who afflict his people and will restore his people, who then will be an everlasting blessing to the whole world. So that is the future of Israel. And so we can see from that God, look, if you're a Christian and you read the Bible, you cannot negate the fact that the Jews are God's chosen people. When you come against the Jews, you poke God in the eye. Isaiah 62, for Zion's sake, I will not hold my peace. And for Jerusalem's sake, I will not rest until her righteousness goes forth as brightness and her salvation as a lamp that burns. The Gentiles shall see your righteousness and all kings your glory. You shall be called by a new name, which the mouth of the Lord will name. You shall also be a crown of glory in the hand of the Lord and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. You shall no longer be termed forsaken, nor shall your land any more be termed desolate, but you shall be called Hephzah and your land Beulah. So that is what God thinks about the Jews. No matter what, how you interpret the Bible, I know that some people interpret everything that I've read as us Christians are replacing the Jews, but that is not so. And as you can see from the fact that the Jews came back to the land, that they are actually in the land, and that you can see what's happening around the world is alerting Christians to the fact that no, Christians have not taken the place of the Jews. The Jews will be the Jews. They are always the Jews, and they will remain, and God has an ultimate future for the Jews. So as far as I'm concerned, everything that's happening in the world right now is crucial for you to understand that we are living in the times that the Bible speaks about that are so unbelievably prophetic that you cannot ignore it. It's in your face. It's right there. And as these things start unfolding, we are going to see more and more prophecy come to pass. Every single week I come to you, I show you these things. And I'm trying to make you see and become aware of the fact that we are living in the times that the Bible speaks about. It's the end times. We don't know how long the actual end of time is going to be, but we can see all of this coming to pass. And of course, the Bible says we are living in the times of the Gentiles. When the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled, that is when God's focus turns back to the Jews. And that is when they see Jesus, whom they pierced, as their savior. And they will see that in the end. And that is what Satan is trying to thwart at this time. He's trying to change what he knows the ultimate plan of God is. So with that, I would like to encourage all of you out there to put your trust in God and to be watching what's happening on the earth right now, because we are definitely moving towards the ultimate fulfillment of prophecy.
3 kilometers from here, you can see my village there. You can see my olive orchards, my pine trees, and my pecan trees. They get shelled every day since the beginning of war.
Joseph, a Christian farmer here, and 12 of his workers recently came very close to losing their lives.
I saw death in my eyes.
We're concealing his identity because he lives among Hezbollah supporters. The farm sits near the South Lebanon border, close to the Israeli town of Metula. Since the Hamas October 7th attack, his village and adjacent farm have come under constant Israeli shelling. March 13th, they were on the farm when Israel struck.
2 minutes after reaching the farm, they hit us with a 120 millimeter mortar. I got hit by a shrapnel on my arm, and when the second mortar was coming, I told the guys to hit the ground and stay flat. It landed 30 meters away from us.
Here is why Israel often targets his and other nearby farms. CBN News has obtained exclusive pictures and videos showing how Hezbollah today here in the southern part of Lebanon is using farms owned by Christians in order to launch their missile attacks against Israel. Joseph took these images a few days after that strike, showing multiple Hezbollah missile systems in the middle of his olive grove.
They keep using our land as a launching pad. They assemble their missiles here, then fire them into Israel.
He's been losing money since daily border fights erupted 5 months ago.
We don't want our land to be a staging ground for war between these two parties. We take no part in this. What's happening in Gaza is not our war.
Joseph says he's repeatedly asked the Lebanese army to intervene, hoping to stop Hezbollah fighters from using his farm, but to no avail. South Lebanon is under Hezbollah control, and Joseph says Lebanese authorities have little sway over the terrorist group.
So, as you can see, it's a very, very difficult situation over there. It is not just cut and dry, black and white, easy. And there are many people that are caught in the middle. As you just saw, you can see Hezbollah using their farmland, which forces Israel to have to retaliate.
Yes.
To them on that land, and the people caught in the middle are caught in the middle, but at the same time, they have to finish what they've started. And so we continue to pray for and support Israel. And, you know, we, as Mom was saying, you know, we do understand what the Jewish people mean for all of humanity. And we our own Bible and our own Savior coming from there, it is very important to us as Christians. And to understand the promise of God that was made to the Jewish people, that we do understand and we do believe it. And so there is, of course, a rift as well with people who don't know what to believe right now. So, but it's very easy if you read the Bible. You can pretty much tell what you should be doing. Okay, everybody, before we go today, if you are giving an offering and supporting our ministry, our missions, and the legacy of my dad, we have some things for you. Now, this book, we've been getting people writing in because they have given an offering and then they want their book. So here's what happens. This is our new book, by the way. It's Prophetic Revelations, a collection of letters from the pen of Kim Clement. My dad's writings in here, just so beautiful, so anointed, will absolutely bless your life. And if you give an offering of $25 or more today, you can get this book. But you have to go to the website and you have to click the banner. You can't just do it, other ways, because there's a few different ways you can do it. Make sure that when you give your offering, it's for $25 or more for this. Make sure you click the banner that says so that you can get this. I want to make sure everybody gets this. And again, for $25 or more of an offering, you can get this. And for an offering of any amount, you can get the Daily Light 31-Day Devotional. This was emails my dad used to write to the team and the staff and the family every morning. He called it the Daily Lights. And so we actually collected the best of these and put them together into a daily devotional. And it is such a blessing. It is so awesome. My dad loved the daily devotionals too, always. So I know he would have loved this. So for any amount, for a gift of any amount, you can get this. And make sure that you click the banner under both of these. So you have to do this at the website if you want the books. But I encourage you to do that and go over to our website and have a look at everything going on there, because we are the House of Destiny Network. And this was, this was founded by my mom and my dad together. And it's very important to us that we keep it going. And it is such a blessing. We're hearing from you guys all the time. But Monday through Sunday, we've got something for you every single day of the week. And, to stay up on Israel, make sure that you watch Israel Update on Fridays, because Christy and Doobie are keeping us updated from the ground in Israel. And they have a lot of insight and will be able to shed light on a lot of things that we may not be sure about. You can find the answers there at Israel Update, and that's on the House of Destiny Network every Friday. And I, of course, will be doing Code Breakers live on Sunday. You don't want to miss that. And Prophetic Rewinds on Monday, and we've been looking at those prophecies. So do join us in the code breaking and the looking at the prophecies as we're in the middle of the fulfillment of all these different things that my dad prophesied about as well. And so thank you so much for joining us today for current events. Make sure you click the banners when you give your offerings so you can get these, because I really want you to have them. I know it will bless you. Okay, is that it, Mom? Are we done for the day?
Yes, we're done.
Well, thank you so much for watching, everyone, and we'll see you next time.
This week's episode of Real Life, Real Faith, we are focusing on the gentleness of Jesus. And I know for a lot of people that grew up in church, there's a lot of pain and hurt based on, you know, perhaps leadership issues that came into play, or just a lot of harsh treatment. And I'm really believing God that as you watch this week, your heart will be restored. Any person who's needing peace, who's needing healing, I'm trusting that you're going to receive it this week. So make sure you tune in and watch Real Life, Real Faith. You can go to real-faith.tv now or follow the link below the player.
No matter what's going on around us, no matter what the enemy have tried to do, it doesn't matter. Guys, God says that you and I, his remnant, those that have been faithful, those that have stood in the face of all of this iniquity, have stood in the face of all of this oppression, all of this that the enemy has perpetrated against you and I, and we stood and we said we will stand. And we will not accept any kind of condemnation. We will not accept any kind of lie that you try to perpetrate upon us. We will not receive that spirit of fear that you are trying to control us with. No, we are standing on the word of our God. And that word is a sure word. God says, this message is for you. For now, he is going to open doors that can't be shut.
We here at the House of Destiny are partnering with you to let our viewers, of course, know about your company. It's Beverly Hills Precious Metal.
Andrew, explain how that works.
So I'll walk you through it right now. So if you go to bh-pm.com, right there on the homepage, you'll see a form that you could fill out. And that form is very important in letting us know how we can help you. So you just put in your first name, last name, email address, phone number. There's a section that says, how did you hear about us? And in there, put Kim Clement. And then there's a portion where you could write a couple of notes down on the bottom. Usually within about 24 to 48 hours, we'll contact you by phone call. And then we'll go over everything with you. This isn't a high pressure deal. We always recommend that if you feel uncomfortable, take a step back, pray about it. You will gain the answers that you need by doing that, and come back to us when you're comfortable.
I'm excited to announce we're having a huge MyPillow spring sale. And here's a few examples. Buy one of our MyPillow 2.0s, you get another MyPillow 2.0 absolutely free. Made with cooling technology, the best pillow ever just got even better. And this just in, 9 brand new colors and styles of our Percale bed sheets. They're made with the finest long staple cotton, and now you can save 50% or more. That's as low as $24.98. And for the first time this year, I'm bringing you our My Slippers and Sandals for as low as $25 a pair. So go to MyPillow.com or call the number on your screen. Use your promo code to get your MyPillow 2.0s. Buy one, get one free. Percale sheets as low as $24.98. My Slippers and Sandals as low as $25 a pair. And for a limited time, when you order $75 or more, your entire order ships absolutely free.